whistle while you work. Put on that grin and start right in to whistle loud and long. Just hum a merry tune.
Welcome to Company Break, a program dedicated to the companies and organizations in our local area, giving them a chance to talk about what services they can provide for you, our WCRI listeners. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Company Break. I'm Mike Mano, very pleased to be sitting this morning with Lauren Dubuque. She is the Executive Director of Masonicare. Good morning, Lauren. Welcome.
Good morning, Mike. Thanks for having me.
It's great to have you here in the studio with us in beautiful downtown Exeter, Rhode Island. And Lauren, let's start from the beginning. Masonicare sounds like it's not a towing service.
Certainly not.
Okay.
Masonicare. If you take Mason and Eye Care and put that together, that's kind of the derivative for Masonicare. I actually run Masonicare at Mystic. So Masonicare is a residential community in Mystic, Connecticut. Our original community is actually located in Wallingford, Connecticut, and has been there for over 120 years. Originally, it was...
You look great.
Catching me off guard.
Oh, okay. So it's been in business for 100 and...
Been in business for over 120 years, okay. Originally only serving Masons as they aged, and then opening up to the public, and in the 80s, they actually opened up to the public in Wallingford, Connecticut, and they've been serving seniors ever since, from a residential perspective, assisted living, memory care, and they have their own skilled nursing and geriatric behavioral health unit in the Wallingford campus. We were built 6 years ago. It'll be 6 years ago this month, and I have happily been with them for 5 years.
All right. And before that 5 years, were you in this area?
So I am born and raised in Mystic, Connecticut, and I have spent my career thus far in healthcare and specifically with geriatrics. Mm-hmm. I was a clinician as a registered dietitian for 10 years, and then I became a nursing home administrator, and then I moved into the sales office in the Mystic building and then took over as executive director. And I've been fortunate in my career to be able to stay in the area, and that's been important to me.
Yeah, well, it's great to be able to grow up someplace. I've, for example, lived in Rhode Island my whole life, and to grow up in Mystic and then end up working in Mystic, that's kind of unique nowadays. A lot of people have to move around a lot. Was there any school that you had to go away to, or was everything right there in Mystic?
No, so I went to school in, I went to UConn to get my undergrad, and I went to the UConn School of Business for my kind of postgraduate work as well.
Okay, but not that far
no.
away. Okay.
Always able to take a car ride home. I always missed the water when I was inland. So
Mystic, a beautiful place to grow up and live and be now, mm-hmm. and be working in that area.
Mm-hmm.
The Masonicare, so the Masons were the original clients, so to speak, or was it a cooperative type of thing?
Well, it's a combination of things. Actually, interestingly, it stemmed originally from after the Chicago fire. Grand Lodge Master in Connecticut sent about $1,000 to the city of Chicago Masons to rebuild. They didn't use it all, and they actually sent some back. And so that the money that they returned, they actually put towards originally serving widows and orphans from the Civil War. And because it was Mason-derived and Mason-sponsored, over time, it was expanding to care for Masons and their family members. And then, in the 80s, as I said, it became a little bit more open to all. And that really is the mission of Masonicare, is serving and open to all for what their needs are.
It's hard to believe that $1,000 was sent and money
came back.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that
unheard
would be,
of.
That would be the fee for delivering it
right.
today.
Right.
Okay, so let's get into the specifics. And you mentioned campus. So there are several areas that you are involved with, or just one that you're directly involved with, and then other ones with the company?
Yeah, so one that I oversee. So the Mystic building was started to be built, but was finished being built 6 years ago. And I think that was really the first time that Masonicare had kind of jumped over to this side of the states or the state. I was familiar with Masonicare because when you work in a nursing home, you sometimes have the need for some geriatric psych behavioral stays for your residents. And so that was something and still is something that Masonicare is known for in Wallingford is behavioral health. So like I said, 6 years ago, this was the first time that they stepped over to the eastern side of the state. And so, you know, we've been here ever since. We've been growing and building. It's 179 apartments in the residential community, and it's made of independent living, assisted living, and dedicated memory care as well.
179 apartments. That's a lot of people to have under your wing, so to speak. What's the kind of turnover that you're talking about if you have 100? Now, 179 apartments could mean 200 people or...
It could, because we have, you know, because you have a combination of independent living, assisted living, and memory care, you may have couples living together in any one of those types of accommodations. We, at this time, have about in the 180s. We are fairly full. We're at about 93% full. And it's a 19-acre campus. It's nice that everything's really under one roof, and it allows people to obviously move about freely, but it also allows people to kind of matriculate through our system the way it's meant to. If someone's living in independent living, they can bring additional care into their apartment if it's needed, but some people kind of have that natural progression to the next level of care, assisted living, where our staff is bringing in care on an intermittent basis, 24 hours a day. And then there's some people who then maybe require a more specialized approach to higher care, those who live with dementia. And then they can move to our memory care, which is a 48 apartment community, which is a very sizable community for dedicated to memory care.
And that obviously involves food that people have to eat during the day.
Yeah, so we say independent living, but it comes with some perks, if you will. So those apartments, you know, may have a full kitchen, so people can do their own cooking, putting together breakfast and lunch, most likely. But they all have one meal per day included as part of their monthly rent, so they can eat in the dining room. They can take it back to their apartments. So even though it's an independent apartment, it comes with the availability of meals. It's a little different in assisted living. Those don't have kitchens, and many of those residents living there wouldn't be able to manage the kitchen. So they have three meals per day included, and same would go for memory care.
Okay. And a website that people can check out while we're talking here that if they'd like to go and check it out?
The easiest thing would go to masonicare.org, and then you can pick from the different locations that we have. We have Wallingford, we have Chester, and we have Mystic. So you can choose the Mystic location, and it will take you directly to our website. And you can essentially take a virtual tour right there for whatever level of care you're looking for. There's a video that is, you know, is kind of taking you through a tour of the community, and then there are pictures of the apartments that are available, talking about some of the amenities, and you know, importantly, how you would be able to call them today to learn more or schedule a tour.
And you mentioned that there is some space available. Is this a good thing for the business that you want space available, or no, let's get it filled up?
Well, as a business, I think it's inevitable that there's going to be space at some point because this is a continuum. So we always want it to be as full as possible. And okay. When we have openings, it just means that there's more opportunities for people to be able to come residents. And, you know, we do actually have a waiting list for our independent apartments. So some people will fill out an application once they've seen the community and they have the feeling that they would like to be part of it at some point. And once they get on the waiting list, if something becomes available, we can then call them and see if the accommodation is something that's going to work for them.
And how many of these residents join on their own or connected with family suggesting that they do this?
I would say it's a combination. One thing that's, I think, special about Masonicare at Mystic, it has brought people from all over. They're not necessarily native to the area. And many residents have either decided that maybe they're from a different part of the state or a different part of the country, but had remembered Mystic fondly from vacations, and they wanted to decide to retire back here. For others, it meant being closer to family. Some people had retired to Florida for a time and then found it harder to be away from family who were up here. And so they're, you know, basically re-retiring back so that they can be close for holidays and for more logistical reasons, if they're having any health issues or they just want the comfort of having someone close by.
One of the things that people don't normally like to talk about in getting involved in this, that there is money involved. There's an expense. There's a whole financial part of it. Do you have some assistance for that when people are saying, I don't know what to do, I don't know how much money I have, can I afford this?
So in the application process, there is a disclosure page. And, you know, we would actually send some of the information, financial information that's disclosed to our finance department if there was question of someone being able to afford. The unique portion about Mystic is that it is considered a monthly rental. So there are many retirement communities that are continuing care retirement communities that there's an upfront buy-in, and that is not the case for Mystic. It is truly month to month. So somebody who's planning or preparing to have, you know, to live with us would, you know, look at their monthly income, their assets, maybe the value of their home, and they could look over time, you know, what that would look like to them financially. And many people, you know, a 6-year possibility of living in independent living is, I think, realistic if people are looking at how long their money is going to last them.
Yeah, that's it's always a guessing game, right? Mm-hmm. There's no magic formula.
Correct.
But you do have the statistics for what the average is.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And that's normally 5-6 years?
So in a month-to-month rental for independent living, it is around that 6-year mark. If someone were coming in at a different point in their life and were coming directly to the assisted living, we might be looking more for 3 years or less. Same thing with memory care.
Oh, right. Well, Lauren, we have lots of other things to touch on, but I want to stop for a little break here. But we'll be specifically, I want to talk about memory care and how all that works with you. We're talking to Lauren Dubuque, for the Executive Director of Masonicare in Mystic, and we'll be back after these messages. We are back on Company Break. I'm Mike Mano, very pleased to be sitting with Lauren Dubuque, the Executive Director of Masonicare, specifically the Mystic location in beautiful downtown Mystic, I would say. And Lauren, we talked quite generally in that first segment about lots of different things that Masonicare is, a little bit about its history, being a rather old as far as others are concerned. Back 125 years, I think, you said?
A little over, yeah.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Over that. So it's that's interesting. It's also interesting to me that a business like this is caring for people always has to have lots of partners. And as they say, the old cliche, it takes a village. I'm sure that's the same case with your business, if we can call it that. And helping people maintain their lifestyle. And one of the things that near and dear to a lot of people's hearts that get to be my age is Alzheimer's and friends or family that are involved with it and connected to it. And it's a little scary sometimes. I had a very good friend out on Block Island that was kind of isolated, and she was going through it where, you know, she was fine for the first 10 minutes and then would ask your name again. And those things are scary, but it's part of life, and that's something you have to deal with, right?
It certainly is. And we work with the Alzheimer's Association in a partnership, and we host a support group monthly. The Alzheimer's Association provides a topic or a speaker or a professional, and people from the community outside of our own residential community are welcome to come in. But it also is a support to the family members who have chosen our community for their loved one living with dementia, Alzheimer's, or any other type of dementia. I know right now we have been kind of talking. Actually, there's been two different support groups this month because the topic was quite interesting and really near and dear to people's heart, because it was talking about preparing for the holidays when you have someone living with dementia with you or otherwise. For us, you know, we do this every day. We've done it for a long time. So we are prepared and understand the challenges that come with, especially holidays, when we're dealing with family members that have dementia. But for many people, this is the first time they've experienced dementia. It's brand new to them. They don't know what to expect. And so this is another time of year where we can be of a great support, in addition to the professionals through places like the Alzheimer's Association, but, you know, our staff as well. Interestingly, this time of the year, and a little before, you know, this wintry season, we start to see families becoming a little bit more weary of or noticing some changes in their loved ones that may already have a diagnosis of dementia but may not. And truthfully, over the summertime, honestly, that those long summer days, oftentimes they do stuff for all of us. I know I feel better on a big long summer day, but for someone that has dementia and some cognitive deficit, those long days actually may cover up some of the deficits that they have. And as we come into the fall, and the days become shorter and it becomes darker earlier, you start to see some, you know, greater deficits or things like sundowning, which is a phenomenon that does happen for people living with dementia. So you start to see someone who's managed fairly well or has covered fairly well kind of unravel a little bit. Maybe there is some more short-term memory, more repetition. Oftentimes there's just there's more confusion, or there's some behaviors that families start to really recognize, and then they start to decide, is this something that I can manage at home? And even if it is something that I can manage at home, is it really in the best interest for my loved one? Especially when families don't have the background in caring for dementia, that starts to be a question. You know, am I doing what's right for my loved one by keeping them here just because I can? Or is there another opportunity that might actually not only keep them safe, which is the first and foremost when thinking about loved ones with dementia, but is there another opportunity where they can be enriched at a level that they can understand at their point in their process? And so this is the time of year where we have, you know, more people, you know, piquing interest about possibly moving their loved one from, you know, living at home or living on their own, which sometimes happens, to a more permanent residential situation like ours, specializing in memory care and having the accommodations that are safe and appropriate for those people living with dementia, but also having that supportive environment and the types of enriching and engaging activities that someone with dementia really benefits from.
I think for most people, they realize that unlike a broken arm, that's something that's not going to heal. And that's a very difficult thing to get over, that hurdle of, if I do this, it's not going to be better a year from now and they can come back again. Mm-hmm. Is that 99% correct or 100% correct?
Oh, it's certainly 100% correct. Dementia is a disease process that's progressive. No two folks living with dementia are exactly the same, but there's going to be similarities and things that we grow to expect as the disease progresses. But it is very rarely something that someone is going to be able to live with us for a significant amount of time and then return home. Now, I will say that we do offer respite care. And respite care is an agreed-upon short-term respite, if you will, for the caregiver. And that's, I think, appropriate, especially earlier on in the disease process. Caregiving for someone who has, you know, little to no short-term memory is exhausting. And for a caregiver to be a good caregiver or for them to continue to have a positive relationship, sometimes they need a break. And so that is something that sometimes people explore with us, maybe 30 days, maybe 60 days, just to kind of give them a reprieve. And for some people who are a little more trepidatious about making it more long term, that initial 30 days where they have a break and they can kind of step back and reevaluate how they're doing and then seeing how their loved one's doing, sometimes that just is the opportunity that they need to feel comfortable with making it a more long term and permanent residency, because it just they start to see how it's better for them as a husband, wife, or family member, and that they see that their loved one is safe and thriving, and they're getting things that no one caregiver in their own home could provide for. When you have a staff of nurses, when you have a staff of certified nursing assistants, when you have a dedicated memory care coordinator, and you have recreation assistants who can all speak to all the different things that make a person whole, the physical, the emotional, the psychosocial, that's impossible for one person to be able to do consistently. And so that's what we're able to do in our environment.
So when you talk about quality of life, it's not just the quality of life for the person that's suffering, but for the family members, that is this really what they want to do for, you know, a year, 5 years,
right,
whatever it turns out to be. And there's probably no schedule you can look at and say, well, this is only going to be a year, so I'll do it for a year.
Right.
It ends up being just going on and on.
Yeah, I think just like it's rather insidious. So just like someone gradually gaining weight, they don't recognize it until they step away from it and then come back to the mirror. And so I think, you know, especially husbands and wives or children and family, you know, they just step in kind of organically when the other person is falling short for something, whether it be activities of daily living, managing the house or otherwise. So sometimes caregivers get into the thick of it, not even recognizing that that's what they are doing. One hand starts washing the other, and before you know it, it's become this relationship of dependency. and so, you know, for caregivers, a lot of times they've taken away their original relationship. Maybe they're no longer really husband and wife. It's caregiver and the person who's being cared for. And so oftentimes when they've decided that they're going to transition their loved one to our type of residency, they take off that caregiver hat and they can go back to visiting with their husband, their wife, their father, their, you know, their mother. And that heavy burden of caregiving, and you know, sometimes some resentment that can go along with that. Those things kind of peel away, and you can get back to just that original relationship that you had before the disease started to take hold.
Yeah, that's going to be one of the toughest situations, where there's a husband and wife type situation where one is fine, quote unquote, mm-hmm. and the other one needs help, mm-hmm. and the caregiver is thinking perhaps that they're doing everything they can, mm-hmm. but as you mentioned, there's no way in the world they can do all the things mm-hmm. that your staff can do.
Right.
And so at some point in time, they have to realize that this has got to change. Now, husbands and wives can move into an apartment, though, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've had instances where, I mean, it's rare, but I've had husbands and wives who were both needing of support services who have lived together in memory care. There have been husbands and wives who have moved into different living situations but can remain under the same roof. Recently, I had a couple who had kind of a failed first trial in a different type of living situation, and the wife was needing of memory care, and the family was very nervous because their first trial didn't go so well, but she did really marvelously in our memory care, and so the husband then decided that he would move into our assisted living so that he could be near her, visit her, but he's getting the level of care that he needs, and she's getting the level of care that she needs. So that looks different to different couples, but there are several opportunities for couples to remain, even if they're not in the exact same apartment, they're within the same community and they can experience each other every day.
Is there a good time? You mentioned at this time of year, some of these things seem to come to light. Is there a good time that's better than another to inquire? Do you wait till, I should wait till springtime, or I should wait till holidays are over, or is that all excuses and waiting?
I think that tends to be excuses because we put off things that are change. Change is difficult for a lot of people, and especially for people who have maybe lived in the same home for 50 years. I would say there's never a bad time to inquire. I would say that if you are a caregiver or and you are caring for someone, whether they have cognitive deficit dementia or maybe it's more physical and they need physical assistance, what I would say is don't wait until that kind of culminating knee-jerk moment. Making some plans and knowing what you want in a community so that when that time comes, when it's evident you may need that, doing that sooner than later allows you to be part of that that informed decision of where you decide you want to live.
So don't put off tomorrow what you can do today.
Correct.
All right. Let's also, and I know you mentioned in the first segment that there's a website that people can go to. And is there an actual phone number people can call?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, the old-fashioned way?
Absolutely. It's not an 800 number. You can call us directly. You can call our front desk, who can always direct you to myself or Amy and our sales department. So the main community is 860-415-2500. Or you can call our sales and marketing office directly and speak with Amy. And that's 860-415-2503.
And the website?
Still, I would go to masonicare.org, and you can that way you can look at all the different offerings that we have and then click on the Mystic location.
Okay. Masonic Care. So it's actually Mason
Eye Care. All one word. Mm-hmm.
As long as you're spelling it out.
Right.
Masonicare.org.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Lauren, thank you so much for explaining all the things you've explained. Time flies when you're on a subject like this, and there's a million things you could talk about. I know that I personally have a lot of things I would love to spend an hour talking to you about, but that's not going to happen on this show. But thanks for coming in and speaking to our audience today.
It's been my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Anyone back at the ranch that you want to mention, or everybody's
my whole team? My whole team is what makes the place special. So hello to all of them.
All right, and the rest of you, we'll see you next time on Company Break.
Whistle while you work.
Thank you for listening to WCRI's presentation of Company Break. I'm Mike Maino, hoping you have a great weekend.